Today we will study from the book of Romans. Okay, Romans chapter 1. Sharon, can you read up to verse 17? Yeah, and who else can read? Naveen, maybe can read 18 to the end of the chapter. Okay, it's a long passage, but want you all to listen attentively as it is read. You can read it in your own Bible in the language you are comfortable with. Okay, and then we will discuss, we will study it together. Yeah.
Chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand to his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, regarding his son, who as to his earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the spirit of holiness was appointed the son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ the Lord. To him we receive grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. And you also are among those Gentiles who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be his people, to be his holy people, grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is being reported all over the world. God, to myself and my spirit, in preaching the gospel of his Son, is my witness how constantly I remember you in my prayers at all times, and I pray that now, at last, by God's will, the way may be open for me to come to you. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong, that is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I plan many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now, in order that I might have a harvest among you, just as I have had among the other Gentiles. I am a debtor both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith.
परमेश्वर का क्रोध तो उन लोगों की सब अभक्ति और अधर्म पर सर्व से प्रकट होता है जो असत्य को अधर्म से दबाए रखते हैं, इसलिए कि परमेश्वर के विषय का ज्ञान उनके मनों में प्रकट है, क्योंकि परमेश्वर ने उन पर प्रकट किया है उसके अनदेखे गुण, अर्थात उसकी सनातन सामर्थ्य और परमेश्वर जगत की सृष्टि के समय से उसके कामों के द्वारा देखने में आते हैं, यहाँ तक कि वे निरुत्तर है। इस कारण कि परमेश्वर को जानने पर भी उन्होंने परमेश्वर के योग्य बढ़ाई और धन्यवाद न दिया, परंतु व्यर्थ विचार करने लगे, यहाँ तक कि उनका निर्बुद्धि मन अंधेरा हो गया, वे अपने आप को बुद्धिमान जताकर मूर्ख बन गए और अविनाशी परमेश्वर की महिमा को नाशवान मनुष्य और पक्षियों और चौपायों और रेंगने वाले जंतुओं की मूर्त की समानता में बदल डाला। इस कारण परमेश्वर ने उन्हें उनके मन की अभिलाषाओं के अनुसार अशुद्धता के लिए छोड़ दिया कि वे आपस में अपने शरीरों का अनादर करें, क्योंकि उन्होंने परमेश्वर की सच्चाई को बदल कर झूठ बना डाला और सृष्टि की उपासना और सेवा की, ना कि उस सृजनहार की जो सदा धन्य है। आमीन। इसलिए परमेश्वर ने उन्हें नीच कामनाओं के वश में छोड़ दिया, यहाँ तक कि उनकी स्त्रियों ने भी स्वाभाविक व्यवहार को उससे जो स्वभाव के विरुद्ध है बदल डाला। वैसे ही पुरुष भी स्त्रियों के साथ स्वाभाविक व्यवहार को छोड़कर आपस में कामातुर होने और जलने लगे। पुरुषों ने पुरुषों के साथ निर्लज्ज काम करके अपने भ्रम का ठीक फल पाया। जब उन्होंने परमेश्वर को पहचानना ना चाहा, तो परमेश्वर ने भी उन्हें उनके निकम्मे मन पर छोड़ दिया कि वे अनुचित काम करें। इसलिए वे सब प्रकार के अधर्म और दुष्टता और लोभ और वैर भाव से भर गए और डाय और हत्या और झगड़े और छल और ईर्ष्या से भरपूर हो गए और जो गुणखोर बदनाम करने वाले परमेश्वर से घृणा करने वाले दूसरों का अनादर करने वाले अभिमानी सींग मार बुरी बुरी बातों के बनाने वाले माता पिता की आज्ञा ना मानने वाले निर्बुद्धि विश्वासघाती माया रहित और निर्दयी हो गए। वे तो परमेश्वर की यह विधि जानते हैं कि ऐसे ऐसे काम करने वाले मृत्यु के दंड के योग्य है, तो भी ना केवल आप ही ऐसे काम करते हैं वरन करने वालों से प्रसन्न भी होते हैं।
Today we may not be able to study the whole chapter, though we read it, but it's good to serve as a background for us to understand. And maybe sometimes during the Friday Bible studies and some other opportunities on Sunday, we will cover this entire book. May not be verse by verse or chapter by chapter, but at least as a theme, we will cover the whole thing so that we get an idea of what Paul is writing about. Okay. Now, many times in my early Christian life, you know, after I came to know the Lord, I would read the Gospels. Then there were some good books like Jonah and all, which were easy to understand. Then Acts was good. Then when I came to Romans, gaadi derail ho jata tha. You know, you couldn't go past a few chapters. It was really tough. Then some books like Revelation and all used to again be good because not because I understood it much, but because it made me frightened and think about God and things like that. I used to read it. But later on, as God started working in my life, this book became really wonderful and dear. Okay. So I remember like many years back, about 30 years back in Bombay, when I was taking a Bible study as a young boy, no, in my own home, when we started this book, a lot of people got interested, and in our home, there was no place to sit. Around 40 young people would gather, 35 to 40, every Wednesday to study this book together. Okay, so a lot of beautiful things are being addressed. Many questions that are there in our hearts and minds get addressed in this book. And if we really want to live out the gospel, then we need to have a good understanding of salvation. Okay, very good understanding of what God did for us. Okay, and only when we are firmly grounded in our understanding of salvation, we will be able to also relate in a Christian way to our colleagues, our friends, our relatives who don't know the gospel yet. Okay. So the manner in which we relate to them, the words that we utter to them, whether we are silent or we are exuberant about the good news, you know, everything depends on what we understand of salvation. Okay. And what is our role in that beautiful work that God is doing on this earth. Okay. There was also one book, one good book on Romans that I read, which really thrilled me. Okay. Unlike most study books, this was very unique and different. It is available on Kindle, not written by me. So I'm not trying to promote it sale. But any of you want to can download from Kindle, it might be just 250 or 300 rupees and read it on your mobile handset. The name of the book is How to Be a Christian Without Being Religious. How to Be a Christian Without Being Religious. It's written by a person called Fritz Ridenour. Okay. Normally, shaped by what we hear from our parents, what we see in our churches, okay, what we pick up from other believers, old and young, you know, something gives us the feeling that we have to be serious, you know. Some Christians smile and laugh. There are others who think that, you know, you need to be serious in God's presence. And if someone smiles, then they will think that it is an irreligious or unspiritual act. okay, what dress we wear, what is acceptable, what is not acceptable. You know, many times we have ratings like that. Somebody has come dressed in a particular way, we'll rank that person as religious, spiritual, or spiritual. Okay, just by looking at what he dresses. Yeah, the way his hair is, how long it is, how short it is. You know, we rank people and rate people and decide in our heart whether they are religious or not religious, irreligious. So when you when you read the book of Romans, one thing you will realize is that all these things perhaps don't make any meaning or sense. You know, in reality, they have nothing in themselves to up your relationship with God or to get you closer to God. A fellow who has got crew-cut hair might be as far away from God, because God is not looking at whether his hair is cut or what he is wearing or what he, you know, how he is smiling or how serious he is when he is fellowshipping in a Sunday meeting or anything like that, you know. So many things may have to be thrown out from our attitudes. Even though we might have seen good Christians doing it, we may have to throw it out so that we become what God wants us to become. And we are able to reach out as Jesus reached. People call Jesus friend of sinners. We want to be called friend of religious, righteous. And our definition of religious and righteous may be absolutely wrong. Okay? We may be calling someone, because God told Samuel, no? Who was a prophet and a very, someone who really had a deep and good relationship with God. God had to tell him, man looks at outward appearances, but God looks at the heart. Even Samuel was wrong. Okay. So many of the habits which we pick up, many of the behaviors in relationships, many of the ways in which we look at people and define them, you know, may be absolutely wrong. Okay. And because there is a majority doing it, we may feel we are absolutely correct. Okay. Every Pharisee in Israel would have thought he is correct and he is doing the right thing. Okay. But Jesus had to call them whitewashed tombs. All decay and death inside you and outside looking gloriously good. Okay. So when God looks at us, what is he going to look at us as? Whitewashed tombs or as people who have been renewed, refreshed, friends of sinners, you know, as he is. You know, becoming a friend of sinner is not to be afraid or frightened about. Okay. So when you read the book of Romans, you will be challenged to think in a different way and live in a different way and set right things in your life, you know, so that you might become fruitful and productive. Okay. It covers one doctrine majorly, the doctrine of salvation by grace alone, okay, by faith. It covers it. But the implications are also covered. Because if you believe that, then there is a way in which you need to live. Paul doesn't believe in just pumping head knowledge or stuffing it into people's head. If what you believe does not result in first change in yourself, then it cannot produce changes in others. No matter how much vocabulary you have, how much you spend time in talking to other people about it, it cannot produce any change in anyone else. Okay, if it does not bring about the changes within you. Okay. So how to be a Christian without being religious? It was something which was an eye opener. Okay. And he defines religious as something, you know, like the things people do to get or win God's favor. Okay. Somehow, even though we may break bread every Sunday, we certainly have given our life to the Lord. Yet, there are many things which we continue to do thinking that it is bringing us close to God, including cutting our hair short. How many of us will dare to keep our hairs long? Okay. There are many other things like that which written or unwritten way may we have decided this equals righteous, this equals irreligious, and we will shun from it. So things people do, Christians also are good at it, and we as believers are even better at it. Things which we do to get or win God's favor, that is what he defines it as. Okay. So this book was written by the Apostle Paul. Chapter 1 verse 1 declares it. It was written during Paul's third missionary journey. Okay, he undertook three major journeys. This was written during the third journey. He was in Corinth at that time when he wrote it. Okay, you can know that by the references that he gives. You can read chapter 16 verse 22. Can someone who finds it, read it quickly. Acts chapter 16 lists a lot of people, okay, in the church at Rome. It also lists a lot of people who were hanging around with him at that time.
I, Tertius, who wrote this epistle, salute you in the Lord.
I'm sorry, you'll have to go one more verse.
23?
Yeah.
Gaius, mine host, and of the whole church, saluteth you. Erastus, the chamberlain of the city, saluteth you. And Quartus, a brother.
Okay. Erastus is mentioned as the city's
chamberlain.
Okay, very difficult to understand the King James. Sometimes a simpler version will help you better. Who is the city's director of public works? That is how the NIV would translate it. Director of public works. Okay. So in Corinth, a stone was excavated. Okay. One street they found, old ancient street. So when they unearthed the street, they also were able to locate a plaque that described who built that street. Okay, it is built by a person called Erastus, the commissioner of public works. Okay, probably the same person, a very high ranking official in Corinth who came to know the Lord, believed, and who had a great public role in Corinth. Okay, he is also one who sends greetings. Okay, it was written by Paul, and it was written around AD 57. Okay. The time is about 5 years after Nero ascended the throne in Rome. Okay. Nero was one of the worst emperors, burnt a lot of Christians. You know, one of the major persecutions broke out when he was the ruler. He ascended the throne when he was just 17 years of age. Okay. And this book is written to the Romans around 3 years after Nero ascended the throne. So Nero must have been around 20. There was no persecution at that time. The church was enjoying a time of peace. Another 5-6 years down the line, everything would become upside down for the believers in Rome. Okay. And Paul himself, in this book, when Sharon was reading, she read about that passage about how Paul longed to go to Rome. Okay, that was his desire. He had not gone there. Okay, he longed to go there. And his desire was that, you know, he could play a part in the spiritual growth of the Roman believers. Okay, that is what his desire was. And he wanted to go, but Somehow he says God kept stopping him. He was not able to go. Finally, he would reach Rome. Okay, the last chapters of the book of Acts will tell you the circumstances and situations which led to Paul finally making his way to Rome. He would go as a prisoner. Okay, because people wanted to kill him in Jerusalem. And when he appears before Festus and Agrippa, he appeals to Caesar. Okay, so they decide that they can't close the case there since he has already made an appeal, and they send him with under armed escort to Rome to face trial. Okay, so Paul would come there to Rome, not as he wanted to. Okay, he was in house arrest for some time till finally Emperor Nero would end his life. He would get killed. Okay, and give his life in that city. Okay. In Rome, the gospel came not through the work of any of the major apostles, not the work of Peter or Paul directly, okay, but believers who had witnessed the day of Pentecost. They had come for the Passover celebrations, okay, in Jerusalem, and they witnessed the trial of the Lord, his crucifixion, his death, then the news breaking out that he had risen again, okay, and those who waited till the feast of Pentecost, they saw another amazing thing, those events that are there in Acts chapter 2, okay. The passage, I think verse 21 of that chapter, tells you that people from Rome were there witnessing what was happening. Many of them would have gone back home with the big news that Jesus had died, he had risen, and you know, all those glorious events of Acts chapter 2 had taken place. They would have carried back those memories, told everyone that they met, okay? And among the Jews and Gentiles in Rome, there were many who had become believers, okay? The church was predominantly Greek or Romans or Gentile in nature, lesser in Jewish content in that sense, no? If you read chapter 16, it lists a whole lot of people, and a lot of them are Gentiles like you and me, okay? So in this prominent city, it was the most prominent city of that time, okay? People would have wanted to go to Rome, how people want to go to the States today, okay? So people would have wanted to go to Rome and live and you know, spend their time in those posh, plush, beautiful things that are there in that city, okay? We all have dreams like that. Who wants to be in a rural villages type of atmosphere, no? So everyone wants to go like that places. So in those days also it would have happened, okay? But the gospel spread there, and Paul wanted to play a big role, okay? Paul was a traveling evangelist, and this is the book that he had written. Okay. When you think about salvation, what are some things that come to your mind? You know, when I was doing my master's pharmacy, my guide, he was from Christian background, not a believer. Okay, he was from the Jacobite church. When I shared the gospel to him, his first question was, what about the tribals who have never heard the good news? You know, when you start sharing the gospel, you'll have questions like that. What about children who get aborted? What about children who die very young? Okay. What about tribals who have never heard the good news because no one thought that they should go and give the good news to them? Many questions come to our mind. Sometimes even we struggle with it. Sometimes we give up. Okay. Sometimes we feel like, you know, what is all this? No, we are disturbed, but we don't do anything. When you study the book of Romans, answers will come for everything. This is a book which answers All those questions, so I will not jump into answers. You will have to discover it yourself. Okay. Very recently, no, in 2000, I think it was 18. That is about 3 years back. One news had come, no, somewhere in November 14 to 17, 18th, I think it was. That's my mom's birthday. Okay. The news came that American missionary John Chow, anyone remember him? Sentinelese people. He had come all the way from there. He tried to make contact with a tribal group, which, you know, the Indian government prevents contact with others very strongly. And they also don't like anyone coming to meet them. They normally welcome them with a shower of arrows and finish them off. Okay. So he did make contact. He set out on 14th, on 15th. One full day he spent with them, 16th, 17th, I think he died, you know. In his diary, details, you can get it in the net if you want, okay, because some of the things that he has written are already there in the public domain, okay. He believed in his heart very sincerely this was Satan's last stronghold, okay, because who else but Satan want a people group to live and die without hearing the gospel and make laws to prevent people from mingling with them. Okay, so he believed that earnestly, sincerely. Okay, he had no idea about their language, but he came and he died. Was his death futile, wasted, useless? You know, you need to think about it. Okay. If he did that, are we also responsible to do something somewhere? You know, does God have a plan of that kind for us to take the gospel to someone else to whom we think is Satan's stronghold today? But we need to share the gospel. You need to think about it. But his death brought to light the plight of the Sentinelese people. We had prayed a lot for them. Okay. And many Christians across the world started praying for the Sentinelese. Okay, someday someone will be able to actually make contact and bridge the gap. Okay, we need to continue to pray for these people. Okay, here Paul decided or wanted to go to Rome, but finally when he went as a prisoner and he died a martyr there. Okay, but Rome, over the next three centuries, was almost converted. You know, 40-50% of the population had become Christian by then, okay, including many of the ruler's close associates. Okay, so in his diary, John Allen had written Soli Deo Gloria, okay, and his last note to his parents was, I love you and pray none of you will love the world more than Jesus Christ. Okay? I pray that none of you, that's what he wrote to his dad and mom, okay, that none of you will love the world more than you love the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? How did this deep passion come for the lost? Or people who are on the road to hell. Okay, how did it come? It came because of a clear understanding of salvation. Okay, when the understanding of salvation in our head is muddied and unclear, you know, it is unlikely that you will have even a pinch of pain towards those who are dying. You may be working with them day and night in the office, but you won't be able to share the gospel because you don't feel anything for them at all. Okay? So we need to understand that a lot of changes need to take place in our life. Okay? It has to start with us. It has to start within us. Okay? Only then the effect will be rubbed off. Yesterday we saw myself in bits and pieces, but my wife saw almost all of it. I think Linson's family was there, John's family was there, children's program, okay? More than 85 kids were participating from across different countries, many from the countries which forbid the gospel, okay? And who was sharing the gospel in these meetings and teaching children? People who are living in those forbidden countries, where if you are openly preaching, there is nothing but going to jail, you know? And I think Sudha's sister is one of them who leads. And so many people that she shares about are Muslim converts, you know, women who know the Lord, but whose circumstances and situations are such that except, you know, with a small group of believers, they can't. But somebody shared the gospel to them. Somebody told the love of God to them. Today, they belong to the family of God. Okay? So, we need to remove the cloud that hangs over this doctrine of salvation in our hearts. Okay? So that we are more effective. Okay? I will not be taking whole of this chapter. I'll take a little bit. You can read the book, okay? And as and when we get time on some Sundays or some Fridays, we will take up this topic to its logical conclusion, okay? It starts like this. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who as to his earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him we receive grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. And you also are among those Gentiles who are called to belong to Jesus Christ, to all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be his holy people. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so today we will have a look at some of the things that Paul is telling us about the gospel. Okay, then we will go into the details as Paul writes it out in the book of Romans. Okay, but first one chalak, one glimpse as Paul gives it. Okay, first of all, he says that the gospel has messengers. Okay, people who take the gospel to those who don't know. Okay, for that he says he was called. Okay, Paul calls himself the servant of God. Okay, servant, the Greek word which is used is doulos. Okay, servant of God. Many times we like to call ourselves servant of God, but if anyone steps on our toe, we try to show we are the master of that place, isn't it? If somebody doesn't do the way we think a thing should be done, then we give a piece of our mind. You know, we stop becoming, we are servants in titles, but not servants in our heart. But Paul called himself a servant of God. The word is doulos. It's like a slave. Okay, he was a slave of Christ. A slave doesn't have rights. A slave doesn't have a voice. A slave does only what the master wants. And he gets rewarded by whatever the master gives. He cannot expect, you know, big things. So Paul calls himself a servant of God. Okay, are we truly servants of God? That is what we need to think about first. Okay, and he says he was called. Okay, a servant is called. It is the master's choice. Okay, I don't become someone who proclaims the gospel or someone who does anything at all in God's kingdom because I wish to do it. Okay, everyone is called to do something. But if you think you're not called, then you need to read Matthew chapter 28, विच वॉज ग्रेट कमीशन या वॉज 20 18 टू 20 यू नीड टू रीड ओके सो दैट ग्रेट कमीशन इज फॉर होम फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस ओके सो डोंट थिंक यू नो यू आर नॉट बीन कॉल्ड यू नो वन फेमस मिशनरी सेड दोस हु आर सिटिंग एट होम डूइंग नथिंग सेइंग दे आर प्रेइंग ओवर इट यू नो वेटिंग फॉर द कॉल जस्ट नीड टू रीड द Open the Bible and read it, and they will hear the call because it has been given many centuries ago itself for each one of us. You need to go. Okay, we are called just like Paul was called, called and set apart for the gospel. Set apart. Okay, you are not set apart. I have finished almost my I'm in the last year before my retirement in the company. Okay. So I was not set apart to be a pharmacist. We were all called to be influencers, you know, or people with the Great Commission to do something. Okay. It doesn't mean we don't have a role in our secular life, but if we do that without, you know, having something to do with the things of God, then it is a tragic end to anyone, okay, or a tragic choice in your life about your career, okay. So called, set apart for the gospel of God, and he called himself apostle, okay, or that was the designation, or sent one. Apostle simply means sent one. He was called, he was set apart, he was sent. Same way as each one of us, we are called, we are set apart, and we are sent by our Lord. Okay, so that's the first thing that we need to understand. Matthew chapter 24, verses 45 to 51. Can someone read it loudly?
Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you, that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. But and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, My Lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servants, and to eat and drink with the drunken, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Okay. The fellow gets treated just like an unbeliever, actually. Okay, in this parable. But the important thing for us to understand is, as a servant, we consider each one of us as servants of the living God, isn't it? So we have a responsibility. He has given it, and he will come back to take an account from us of what we did as a servant. Okay, those who are faithful will be rewarded. Those who have been unfaithful will be punished. Okay, we don't have an endless life. Okay, and just because you're 30 or 40, don't think that you have got many. Yes, many have died young. Okay, many of you know, with all the white hair on my head, I can tell you that there are many whom I have seen, my friends, who have died very young. Right from my school days till now, every year at least one or two of my close friends have gone. Okay, each year. Okay, so don't assume that you have much to do. Okay, the second thing that we know about the gospel, okay, gospel as messengers, that was the first one, and we are all part of that team. And the second one is the gospel was promised. Okay. What does Paul say? The gospel was promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Okay? The gospel was promised beforehand. It is not something that Paul is writing about now, but it was foretold beforehand and it was written down in the Bible. So that, you know, when those events started taking place in the world, everyone knew that this is what was told. Okay, right in the Garden of Eden, when the first sin took place, and the Lord you know, rebuked Adam and Eve for their act and gave and punished them, he also cursed Satan, okay, the serpent. And he told, by her seed will smash the head of your seed. Okay. And that is how it would be. The gospel was given. The first thing that the Lord told after man sinned was the gospel. Okay. It will happen. God will come in the flesh and he will strike the head of Satan and cripple him forever. Okay. Right from the beginning, the first book of the Bible, every book will tell you a little bit about the gospel. The Jews had a temple. The way, the direction in which the temple was, you know, the east, west, some other time we can study the direction, the entry from the west. Everything proclaims something about the gospel truth. Every ritual they did inside had something to do with the gospel, to proclaim it. So through their actions, through their practices, it was embedded in the culture of those people what was going to happen. Even if you read the feasts that the Jews were asked to celebrate, okay, each feast told about a particular event that will take place in the future, and it described it beautifully. All those events took place. So God gave a calendar. He built it into their culture so that they would know and they would understand. Okay. So the gospel was promised. So every writer in the Old Testament in some way or the other refers to man, sin, salvation, God, and his graciousness. Okay. Third thing, the gospel is about a person. Okay, the gospel he promised before and through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son. Okay, the gospel, you remove the Lord Jesus Christ from the story of salvation and there is no gospel at all. Okay, the gospel has to do with only one person, the son of God, that is Jesus Christ. Okay, that is why that book that Fritz Ridenour wrote, no? How to be a Christian without being religious, tells about how all religions are man's effort to search for God, to get close to him by winning his favor and trying to bridge the gap. Okay, but Christianity is a relationship with a person who loves us, okay, and who is gracious, who is merciful, okay, without the Lord Jesus Christ in that story, there is no gospel at all. So these days we are close to Christmas, okay. So what is the popular way of denoting Christmas now? Xmas, isn't it? You remove Christ and put it so that it looks secular and good and appealing to others. Okay? But it is Christ and a relationship with him that is spoken of as the gospel. Okay? It is not man doing something to please God. That will not get you any far. Okay? That is what Abraham realized. You know, he was dead, his wife was dead, and he faced that fact. Okay, you need to face the fact that nothing that you do will help you even move 1 millimeter close to God. That's not possible. It is God reaching out to us. That's the story of the gospel, and that gospel has to do with his son, because he was a key player in bringing the good news to each one of us. Okay. So, this passage identifies Jesus as someone who descended, human descent was through David. Okay? We are all human. बट ओनली जीसस वॉज बोथ गॉड एंड मैन ओके ही वॉज डिवाइन फुल्ली गॉड एंड ही वॉज फुल्ली मैन ओके नॉट हाफ गॉड हाफ मैन ओके बट ही वॉज फुल्ली गॉड एंड फुल्ली मैन द ओनली पर्सन ओके एंड सो हाउ डिड गॉड हेल्प अस आइडेंटिफाई हिज ह्यूमन डिसेंट वुड बी थ्रू द लाइन ऑफ डेविड ओके दैट वुड बी क्लियर एंड द सेकेंड थिंग वॉज एंड हु थ्रू द स्पिरिट ऑफ होलीनेस वॉज डिक्लेयर्ड विद पावर टू बी द सन ऑफ गॉड डिक्लेयर्ड विद पावर to be the son of God. Okay, what was that event? Through his resurrection from the dead. Okay? Every human being dies. 100% all of us will die. Okay? When I was in the hospital in ICU with COVID, okay, I thought this is it. Okay? Because that's how my body was. Going down, sinking. Okay, I could see others dying. And everyone in the heart of hearts knows that someday you will die. Okay? When Mary and Martha, Lazarus was dead, and the Lord delayed in coming, and then he arrived, what did they say? If you had been here, okay, what they thought in their heart, that line up to which you can help has already been crossed. If you had come even when they were terminally ill, before their last breath, maybe something could have been done. That's what they were saying when they said, if you had been here, he would not have, this would not have happened. That means Jesus could do nothing after that line was crossed. Okay, all humans, we all understand it, that death is final. It is inevitable. In fact, my dad used those very words. You know, those were among his last words before he slipped into, unconsciousness and then he went to be with the Lord. Okay, it is inevitable. You know, whatever struggle you may do, whatever you may spend, whatever science and good hospitals and good doctors and consultants you bring, but a day will come when the inevitable will happen. And when it crosses the line, it is finished. Everyone knows from Adam till now, every single person knows. That is why when we see an accident, we first look whether jinda hai kya mar gaya. You know, that type of a thing. People are knowing that it is finished or not finished, that's all. But no one comes back from the dead. Okay? So God, the Spirit of God, raised our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, declaring or proclaiming that he is the Son of God. You know, he was human. He cried with pain when the nails were driven down his hands and feet. He would have shrieked with pain with every whip stroke that was given on his back. When the crown of thorns were placed and a rod was used to hammer it into his head, he would have cried just like you and me. And everyone watching would have thought, could this really be the Son of God? Nobody would have thought, you know, a person who can suffer, even a human being doesn't suffer that much before he dies. You know, everyone their thought would have been, could this really be the Messiah? Okay? So what God did when Jesus was resurrected, that line which everyone believes cannot be crossed was crossed. Someone came back from the dead. Okay? The resurrection is a reality. There is one place and only one place on the earth where Christianity could not have been born. Okay? And that is Jerusalem. If the resurrection was a lie. Because anyone in Jerusalem could have walked to the tomb to see and convinced himself that Jesus was inside. Okay, that would have been the last place where Christianity could have been born if that had not really happened. But God raised
Jesus from the dead, proving to the world that he is the Son of God. Okay? So the good news is about this person, the Lord Jesus Christ. God evidenced it through a genealogical connect with King David. God evidenced it by his resurrection, his powerful resurrection from the dead. The word power that comes everywhere in the New Testament, remember, is the same word from which we get the English word dynamite. Okay? Explosive power. Okay? It is actually the same word which is used in the Greek language, which is what in which the Bible was written. Okay? So, Jesus was declared with dynamite power that he is the Son of God. So, you are connecting with a person. Okay? That person is connecting with you, the other way you can put it. Okay? Because like Abraham, we face the fact that we cannot. We are dead in sins. We are helpless. And the connect has to be established with someone with that dynamite power, okay, who can change and transform us. That is the gospel, okay? I think we can have another 5 or 6 minutes. Then we will continue later, okay? Through him, okay, the third was the person. Now the fourth thing that is mentioned is the gospel is for us. Okay? Paul says, through him we received grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. You know, when you have a relationship with the living God through our Lord Jesus Christ, it is not for anything else, but for obedience. You know, and we as Christians, as believers even, pay scant regard for obedience. We want to know scriptures, memorize it. Bible verse kitna malum hai? Call her up. We are looking at a righteousness with a different, you know, what to say, meaning. It's not attending even Sunday meetings. It is not attending Bible studies regularly. It is not memorizing scriptures. It is not having a crew cut. It is not cutting your nails. It is not being dressed in black and white. It is not carrying a big Bible. Okay? It is not stopping yourself from giving curse words or cuss words. Okay? That is not going to take you anywhere. Okay? The gospel has to do with obedience. When you start relating to that resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, because he is the person with whom the relationship is bridged, what happens? Obedience must result. The good news has to do with obedience. Okay? People who obey is what God wants. You know, a people of obedience. The rest of the chapter, you know, which Naveen had read, talks about the people who didn't opt for obedience. They opted to go away. They opted to suppress that knowledge of God. And what happened to them is given in that portion. Okay? The obedience that comes from faith for his namesake. Not for your namesake, but his namesake. Okay? Whatever he is doing for his namesake. Okay? And obedience that comes from faith. No effort on your part. Salvation has nothing to do, even 1 millimeter, with what you can do. Nothing you can do. Okay? It is by faith and faith alone. Martin Luther was one person who read the book of Romans and was touched. Okay? He was a Catholic priest. Okay? And then he wrote those theses and put it on his church door. Things were, you know, which was wrong with the belief system that he was part of. And he was finally excommunicated and was even, you know, bothered a lot in his life as a result of his faith and belief. But it is the book of Romans that touched him. It's faith and faith alone. From first to last, that is what it says. Okay? And you also are among those Gentiles who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. You know, You were saved so that you will be obedient. You are saved so that you will belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God. Okay. You are loved by God. Okay. That is something that you must not forget. Right through our Christian life, you know, we live as if we are the suffering Lord. इसका कितना अच्छा है, you know, उसका कितना अच्छा है, उसके पास घर है, उसके पास कार है, उसके पास नौकरी है, उसके you know, we compare many things and we find in every comparison we are the only ones who are, we feel we are not loved by God. You know, he loves everyone else but me. But everyone is going through similar struggles only, and we are loved by God. There is no exception. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be his holy people. Okay? Obedience, holiness. This is what God is looking for. Okay? And we have looked at some things about the gospel today. Okay? Two last things we will look at very briefly. I'll just in passing mention it because they are also there in the passage which who read? Sharon read. Okay. Verse 14. I am obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and foolish. That is why I am eager to preach the gospel. What does the word I am obligated mean? Huh?
Yes, reading.
Okay.
Payback.
Debtors. Yeah. You know, if I don't tell the gospel to my, it cannot happen. It is my obligation. I have to do it. There is no other choice. You know, if your next door neighbor, their house is on fire and you're eating food, what will you do? What will you do? It's not difficult to bolne ke liye uttar. Leave the food and run. That is obligation. Your comfort. What is, you know, your preoccupation at that time. TV dekhta rahega to bhi aapko bhaag ke jaake bolna padega. Toilet pe baitha hai to bhi band karke jana padega. To help put out the fire. It is like that. Paul felt obligated that he must do something. He had now entered into that wonderful relationship with that person, the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay. And now he felt obligated. If he does not tell, then he is letting people slip into hell. That's the horrifying thought that was there on his mind. He could not waste a minute. He could not waste a moment before he went and told them the good news. Okay. You know, I had a friend. Some of you would have met him during the camp if you had come to the family camp, Varki by name. You know, his hair and his beard might be difficult for many to digest, but he is a wonderful believer. And his elder sister, Lily, you know, when we were all younger, actually, Sharon's age, more or less, we were all at that time. She was working as a nurse. She had just got a job and she was on the night shift. One day she phoned and told us that there is an old man who is terminally ill and may not make it to the morning. Okay. So she phoned and told, please pray for me. I want to share the gospel. I don't know how to start. I don't know this person, but I don't think he will make it. Okay. So that day turned out to be the worst day for her. Lot of problems in the hospital, lot of patients, you know, having demanding need, and she was not getting time. Okay. Back home, we were all praying. We had prayed and then we had gone to sleep. She was in the night shift. Then a duty ended. 5 minutes before the end, she decided she can't go home, okay, without sharing the gospel. So she sat with him, talked to him, Okay, her time was up, but she spent some time with him and shared the gospel. He wept and he prayed, asking the Lord to enter into his life. You know, Lily went home. On the way, she called us and told, this is what happened. Next day, when she went in the night shift, the bed was empty. Okay? This is what Paul meant when he said, he is obligated. Okay? Lily felt obligated. Very often, we don't feel obligated. That is why we don't share the gospel. When we hear the news that person X has got cancer in our family, then what do? Usko mat batao. Mat batao. Wo ghabar jayega. The reality is, ghabarne do. It is like, now I know to retire. If God willing, I live 1 year, may I retire. It is a notice that is on my head. I know that it is going to happen. God has issued a notice to that person that he is going to go soon. And everyone else, like, are preventing him from doing what must be done in this last few hours before his death or days before his death. Let us not enter into that type of a thing. In Kings, you will read the story of King Hezekiah. God sends Isaiah to him and tells him, put your house in order because you are going to die. You know, God was concerned. He was putting Hezekiah on notice. Marne wala hai, but do what needs to be done. For me, when I was in the ICU, okay, those 7 days in the ICU, my thoughts were active. So many of the sins that I had committed were coming to my mind for me to repent. Okay? And say sorry to God. When we know we are on notice, we will do something. Don't hide information from people on whom God has issued the notice. Okay? You are obligated. When my dad was dying, okay? It was the most wonderful time of my life. With my dad. We had not, you know, my dad is not the kind who is very friendly. Okay? But those 10, 15 days in the end, when he was in the hospital, I was there at his bedside. We had long talks. There were many things that I didn't know he was dying at that time anyway, but there were many things that by talking, I was able to lead him to a point where he could think. I don't know what he did with what came up in our conversations about the Bible, about God, and about other things, okay? But he had time because we spent time and we did what needs to be done. So when you know of a loved one going to be with the Lord, okay, when they are on notice, you need to do what needs to be done. Don't hide the information from them, okay? Let them, lead them through the path of repentance instead. Paul felt obligated. Okay. Last thing. So that is why he was eager to preach. And for I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. Okay. We are ashamed of the gospel. That is why we don't tell about it. We can talk about our prime minister, our home minister, about the party, about the opposition, about cricket, about COVID. We are not ashamed of these things. But we are ashamed about the gospel. That is why we don't talk about it. Okay? Why we are ashamed? Huh? Someone was saying something. We are ashamed because we think kuch hoga nahi. We don't know the value of the gospel. How it is the power of God. That sister Lily, no? She experienced it, no? In just 5 minutes of sharing the gospel to an unknown person who was dying. ओके नॉर्मली व्हाट वी विल लुक एट सच अ पर्सन ना इसको बोल के भी क्या होने वाला है अभी इट इज द पावर ऑफ गॉड टू सेव ओके पीपल्स लाइव्स हैव चेंज्ड अ लॉट यू नो अनदर बुक which is there on Kindle, Child of Satan, Child of God. Susan Atkins. I have shared about it sometime back in the church as well. Okay? She and a group of girls and one person called Mason, okay? They murdered 8 to 10 people and they used to write with the blood of the victim, helter-skelter, on the wall. Okay? A person like that came to know the Lord. Okay? Her mind was warped through drugs, abuse of drugs, and through everything. Okay? The way she grew up, the friends she had, everything. But what happened? She came to know the Lord. When one person chose to visit her regularly in the hospital, in the prison. Okay? So it is the power of God to save to those who believe. Okay? So we will end with that. As we go through the book of Romans, we will be reading it here, there, and like, you know, we'll try to catch a glimpse of what Paul is trying to tell. But much more you will learn if you study on your own. Okay? Because even though I took about an hour, there is hardly 10% of what I learned in this chapter that I was able to communicate to you. And what I learned may be less than 1% of what God wants to teach in this passage. So do take pains to read it, study it, and grow in it. Okay? Maybe Linson can lead us in a closing prayer.